Okay, good morning, everybody. Happy New Year and all the good, nice things we are starting. I don't know whether this is the first seminar in 2017. Not? No. So, I don't have the... Okay. And thanks, everyone. And thanks, David, of course. Globally, as you can see, yes, I am a member of this network. I am a member also of Classy and another network here. But I will say a few words about GlobalX, although if I present it fully, I may take 1 hour or so, so it's probably be very, very brief. But first of all, how many people know GlobalX or have heard of GlobalX? Raise your hands. That means we have been very, very bad at communicating, at least, because GlobalX has been around for 15 years now, so it's quite some years. What is it exactly? It's a network, international network, global network. And GlobalX means exactly that, a global network on the economics of learning, innovation, and competence-building systems. This is what GlobalX is all about. Donc, everything to do with learning, in global terms, innovation and competence building, is our concern as a network of... as you could see, it has been growing very fast and broad. Worldwide research network for more than 2,000 scholars now, members of the GlobalX network. On all continents, I will tell you perhaps a bit more. Participating scholars are mainly economists, but other social sciences, scientists with a focus on how innovation and competence building contribute to economic, sustainable, and inclusive development. So it's really one of the networks we try to link up innovation, competence building, and learning to development and to developing countries. And we have, of course, our website, which you can... go through perhaps and say one or two things about our objectives. What do we do with GlobalX? Contribute to scientific capacity building in the field of innovation and development through networking. Okay. Contribute to the knowledge base for strategies and policies linking innovation to economic development. So we are not only in the research sphere, we try also to do something directed to policy making and to policy makers, so that our findings, our results can be used economically, socially, politically, implemented. To establish a platform from north-south, south-north, and south-south collaboration. This is the reason why we are so broad, because the whole idea is to bring a kind of networking within all spheres, not only north-south, but also south-north and South-South collaboration, and this is, of course, one of the important areas of important objective, and perhaps of more direct concern to you, future, to help PhD students, especially from low and lower middle-income countries, to pursue high-quality research in the field of innovation and development, but not necessarily only from these countries, also from developed countries. We have seen that the interaction between students from the north and the south is also very useful and productive. So basically now headquarters are in Denmark and moving to Brazil soon, being coordinated by somebody. If you know the area of innovation systems, you probably know this person, Bentoke Lundvall, because he's, of course, the one of the key scholars who have set up this concept. We are about 14 members in the scientific board from all regions, from Europe, from Latin America, Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, and North Africa, and Asia. So all regions are represented, and since now the last 10 years, we have started into setting up branches, So now we have branches in Latin America, which is called LALIX, not very difficult to find, Latin America LIX, Africa, Africa LIX, Asia, Asia LIX, and even Europe, the recent one is Europe EuroLIX. You see, there's a lot of imagination in the blue, as you could see. And of course, the we have a yearly international conference, which is the Global LIX conference, which is also the General Assembly of Researchers. The last one was in Bandung, very far, Indonesia. And the next one will be very close, Greece. Deadline for presenting proposals for the next conference is May the 15th. So you have plenty of time, prepare your papers and get them referred and strung. And it's open to all, everybody who has something to say, because there is a scientific board who really, and particularly there is emphasis on helping young scholars to come into the area of research. This is basically what I want to say. And the best way to find out more is, of course, to go to the website. And there you could find everything. We have been producing books and scientific articles. And perhaps before I close this descriptive chapter is we have academies. I think you should know that this might be of interest, direct of interest to you. What are academies? We organize yearly an international academy. An international academy is to train PhD students within 2 weeks' time, and it's moving from various places, one place to the other. And we have, of course, the outstanding state-of-the-art lecturers coming to lecture in these academies. And we usually take 35 students after 200 applications, so we still have a good chance to be on these academies. Everything is paid for by the network. That makes it also interesting. And of course, from there on, we deliver certificates that you have been on the academy. And hopefully, you'll be within the network within the next few years. This is basically what Global LIX is all about. And please do ask me if there is further information you may need. But today, it's not talking about Global LIX. It's really discussing this issue of, as shown on the title, of a global value chain, design engineering, capacity building, issues in the natural resource sector through the expertise, experience of petroleum in Petrobras in Brazil. And I did apologize, particularly to the discussant, because I've had a temptation to slightly change the text. This is what learning is all about. We all learn. That was written about 7 months ago. In between, of course, there are a few elements. And I added, to make it more illustrative, I added another case study, just for you to compare and to draw the lessons from what I am going to say. So please permit me and forgive me. Okay, so I'll be introducing rapidly what we are going to talk, what the issues are. Secondly, I will talk on some more theoretical terms, at least the way we see it and the sources on global value chain, natural resource, and the importance of design and engineering. Third, we will go into empirical study, and this is where we really are going to examine the Brazilian experience. Is there a Brazilian student? One, two, three. Oh my God, I feel so incompetent here in front of all these experts. So if I say silly things, please put it on my ignorance rather than, okay? And I was tempted, as I said, to add another case just to show you that why the experience of Brazil is so outstanding, because in some other parts of the world, of the developing world, similar experience didn't succeed. And we consider the Brazilian experience as a successful operation. This is, I may be wrong, but we'll discuss. And of course, some conclusions, preliminary or partial conclusions, which need to be to be deepened, because this is, of course, an ongoing research project. We haven't completed it, still exploring what linkages we could have between this area of, in global terms, in very general terms, science, technology, innovation, engineering, and the global value chain. This is a new ground which is being broken, and in fact, GlobalX has moved into this ground only 2 years ago. So even we are new, relatively new to this linking, trying to link up GVC, global value chain, and the whole problematics of innovation, competence building, learning. Learning is a key word in this process. So some of the conclusions may not be definite. They are only provisional conclusions, which needs to be further, of course, deepened. Starting from some observations, very general artifacts, dependence on, I mean, everybody agrees that dependence on natural resources is endemic, that is continuous. We don't see an end to it, particularly in this part of the world, in Africa and in the Middle East. There's a lot of writing, so we're talking about the resource curse. I know you know the concept. And that resource curse is, of course, one of the things which translates into this dependence on natural resources. Natural resources in these economies have been crowding out manufacturing. I don't know whether you're familiar with the principle concept of crowding out. Okay, that helps. So manufacturing, as a result, hasn't really emerged as a really alternative means of creating wealth and of growth and developing the countries, because the whole natural resource has taken all the resources, all the energy, all the attention of decision makers. Everybody agrees also that the supply and upgrading of equipment and services is still very much done by foreign companies. Wherever you go, there are attempts to reduce that dependence, even in this part of the world. You could see, for instance, in Nigeria, you could see in Saudi Arabia, that attempts to get some local sources in terms of competition, they are really limited in terms of impact, really. The local research, innovation, and engineering capabilities, on the whole, have been marginalized. In other words, if you look at how much research and innovation has been done in this area of natural resources, of petroleum and gas equipment, for instance, or other resources, very little. Universities are doing their own job in their own environment, but almost totally isolated from what's going on in the natural resource sector. This is isolation. It's something we could find in most countries in that part of the world. And the chances of moving into the global value chain are, therefore, very slim, one non-existent. And what I am saying this is not only in theoretical terms, it's in practical terms. If you look at some of the countries, they have been importing equipment and services for 50 years, I'm not exaggerating, and nothing has changed. They still keep importing equipment and services for development of the natural resource sector. So there is something there which, of course, poses problem. And yet, this is not something which is inescapable in historical terms, because if you look at Scandinavian countries, you know them, Finland, Holland, yeah, they've moved from natural-based economies to more diversified economies. And within, of course, within 150 years, I would say, might be. But they have done it. So that means it is feasible. You can actually, if you have the proper strategy, you can move from being simply supplier of natural resources to really down the chain and produce equipment and produce services which are useful for the natural resource sector. This is in general terms. So some key questions which come out of that, what are the prospects of these countries moving into the global chain, value chain? Is there any chance for them to move into this global value chain? at one stage or another, particularly as we are concentrating on the oil sector. This is put the focus. Of course, you might argue this is a rather specific sector. Yes, I agree. But this is a sector which is of interest to me. Anyway, to what extent building some innovation capacity and design engineering, D&E, in this sector could help GVC integration? While the NSI is National System of Innovation, is a weak or in preliminary form? Are there any chance? Because everybody now, most of the evaluation assessment of these countries come with the more or less the same conclusion. In this country, national innovation system doesn't work, are not there, are disintegrated, and all the negative things. So while we are in the situation of non-existent or non-performing innovation systems, can we still move into GVC like other peoples have done? And of course, in terms of best practices, how did other countries operate to penetrate the global value chain or sector, and what lessons can we draw? And this is where the Brazilian experience became interesting. Because when you examine the experience of more than 50 years, in fact, maybe wrong, they've moved quite successfully in some segments of technology from the state of importing fully the equipment to producing, not all the equipment, of course, nobody would produce, could actually do it. But they have done it, and how, so the question is, how do they do it? Our argument in this work is, yes, we think that integrating and moving the GVC is possible. Okay, it's an optimistic note. In spite of all these years of not moving, we still believe that it is feasible, it is possible. Okay. A country perspective. We think also that you could integrate GVC without having necessarily a fully operational innovation system. In other words, you don't say, we don't have an innovation system, so we can't do anything. No, we still think there are chances that you can move into this GVC, natural resource GVC, without necessarily having fully completed operation. And we think last argument is that design engineering seems to be key element in penetrating the global value chain. Okay? So let's look at what the literature has said briefly, because I haven't really reviewed in depth all the literature. But some of the recent contributions might be worth examining. First of all, value chain, I don't think do we need, but perhaps for those who are not familiar, very briefly, value chains are so many definitions now. It's become a fashionable topic now. Everybody talks about value chain. And so they are right, I think. It's time we looked at value chain in more serious terms. Value chain, various stages of production process, I am quoting from the literature, through which the product gets increasing value. This is one way to do it. The road to the end product, from material to end product, another way of doing it. OECD defines it as the full range of activities that are required to bring a production, its conception, through its design, sourced raw materials, intermediate inputs, marketing, and support to the final and to the final consumer. That is value chain. But when we look at it in global terms, it is clear that now more and more the whole process of production is from raw material to finished product is increasingly carried out globally. It's not being done within the same place, but it is scattered throughout various countries, various places. Whenever the company feels the necessary skills, materials are available and competitive price and quality. That's why value chain become global. Now, two, the concept of global value chain, I think. So moving the to when you come to the natural resource sector, which is our focus, value chain, some of the modes of moving, not all of them, because there's so many ways of doing it, but only two which the literature brings about. One is moving up to the commodity chain within the core activity. Without moving, without leaving the oil sector, you move, in other words, you move through backward and forward linkages, you move from exploration to production to distribution to transformation of oil through refining, production of derivatives, petrochemicals. That is, you move along the chain while remaining into the natural resource sector. You don't move out of it. So this is one way of going through the value chain, which it is, of course, many countries attempting to do it. When we see the number of petrochemical complexes which are being invested and bought in the world, they are increasing. I don't have all the figures here, but increasing rapidly, and they've been increasing for the last 20 years. In fact, ever since we have the oil boom, a lot of people are moving along the chain, at least refining, at least setting petrochemicals, and to some extent distributing as well. But there is a second move also, moving along the non-core activities. That is also remaining in the natural resources, but producing equipment, going into the value chain through the equipment, and for the oil industry. Why? Because equipment, when you produce them locally, you become self-reliant. It is a way of reducing costs. It has an impact on the balance of payment, because oil equipment are very expensive. This is the most expensive part of the bill. And of course, we look at this through the lens of importing STI and STI science, technology, and innovation lens. That means we look at various stages. When you import the equipment, you use them, you adapt them through DE, you undertake research and development activity, and you innovate. So this is brief definition what the global value chain and value chain natural resource is. The GVC through the lens of innovation and learning. As I said, I'm not looking at it in general terms. There are more advanced works and more specialists, better specialists than me on the global value chain in general terms. But on this specific point, we have decided within the globalist network, this is an ongoing project, we have decided that we look at it through the specific lens of innovation and learning. How can we possibly link up global value chain and innovation learning? And what does that produce? So, what is a fact, and we can discuss this, that increasingly moving up the value chain requires technological capabilities. In other words, if you don't have technological capabilities, there is no chance at all of moving along this value chain in either way, in terms of core and non-core activities. Now, we know what the two are. But particularly if you want to move on non-core activities. Increasingly, the capacity to move from one stage to the next requires the capacity to upgrade knowledge. Knowledge, of course, is something which is moving, and you have to upgrade it all the time, bearing in mind all the obsolescence which we characterize knowledge, and we are in the knowledge-based economy, as one might say. Knowledge, learning, and competence building. Okay? And, of course, the capacity in natural resource sector rests on research and DE and innovation. So we have the three crossing spheres. We have GVC is linked up to national system of innovation. In other words, if you have the capacity to do research, to innovate, to upgrade, etc., then you have better chance to penetrate the global value chain. So there is a linkage between global value chain and national innovation system. Global value chain is linked to design engineering, because if you want to move into non-core activities, and even in core, but particularly in non-core activities, design engineering, which is how do you conceive the product, how you think and you put the idea forward and put it in a form, then becomes essential for global value chain. And of course, global value chain and natural resources, we have talked about it. So I don't want to bore you with a full literature review because there's a lot of things going right, left, and center. But few of the what I call the landmarks, some of the work, recent work, which has been on for the last, say, 10 years, 15 years, and which I think is worth looking at when we, of course, refer to the situation of the developing countries, because this is where I am putting the focus on natural resources in countries which are in state of development. There is a famous work done by Gerifi and Kaplansky, which indicates a new pattern of global interaction. Kaplansky is a member of our board, so it's within the Global X family. When you link up global value chain and natural resources, firms in less developing countries confirms what I said, my optimism earlier, confirms that in fact more and more these firms show capabilities to enter in value chain and use their participation to upgrade their knowledge base in all sectors. So this is a fact that we see more dynamism amongst firms. I mentioned, of course, Saudi Arabia, but Latin America, Brazil, and we are going to see how this is being done. There is now awareness, wide awareness, particularly with these oil prices which go on up and down in very erratic form, that this is not going to be last. To be lasting, that you have to find some alternative means to make it sustainable. If you want to make it sustainable, then you have to move out of the natural resource sphere and go further down the line and produce some other, either non-core or core activities. Okay, this is something which, moving from exploitation of natural resources to manufacturing, packaging, distributing, branding can be described according to the terms of Gary Fierkaplesky, climbing the ladder. Okay, this concept of climbing the ladder, the more you, of course, upgrade and you master skill, then you go higher up. But try not to fall down, because that would be painful. Therefore, innovation towards the concept of decommoditization, yes, going from commodity to non-commodity, it's quite complex to pronounce, which means the natural resources will not be only a commodity to sell, but it will be a source of producing value added, of innovation, competence building, and producing added products with increasing added value. I quite like the term of decommoditization. And diversifying the technological capabilities and skills through integration into GVC deepens industrial structure and opens up opportunities to lateral migration. And I have the weakness to put some spot, publicity spot, for the work I've done with Lundwall, and which is published. We have looked specifically on this issue, how we could actually deepen GVC through industrial restructuring, through migration of knowledge. And this is available on the net. If you want to, could have access to this work. It's been on for a year or so. So you can read it, and of course, pleased to have your feedback. On the issue on GVC, natural resource, and the learning process, here again, there are literature that tells us that learning through upgrading the knowledge base within natural sector depends through the development of upstream, downstream, and lateral activities, and learning at policy level. So there is some learning in upgrading policy knowledge at higher level, policy level, but also at the firm level. It's not something to do only with the firm. It is also at policymaking level that policymakers have to integrate the aspect. In the South, the main learning mechanisms are spillover and imitation, or through the ability of firm to meet international standards, while still the same assess the same condition. That is, while national systems of innovation are in the we call it optimistically in the construction stage. Okay, captive chain and symbiont. Okay, that means simply that the fact that you are involved in the value chain is something, international trade, and is something which has some impact in improving your capacity, and by improving your capacity, you move along the chain, and the interaction within national system of innovation interesting, because that means when there is you are in this global value chain, which every company is, that means the institutional setup implies placing of number of national innovation system. In other words, if you are linked up to this global value chain, you have to work to satisfy some international standards. That international standards requires that you upgrade what? You upgrade all components of national innovation system. In theoretically, of course, that your education to have a better or more qualified students to enter the labor market, training and research, you upgrade your research capacity and capabilities within the same sector, to upgrade the technology and research system, and even the institutional system, like legal system, and the standard and norms and standards which you use. In other words, all components. Here, I'm sorry what happened, but there was a beautiful, believe me, there was a very beautiful picture. In fact, the famous the model of Gary Fee Humphrey and Sturgeon, why am I mentioning it? I hope it will come out in later stages. It just shows you that this is the case, but this is not easy. Why? Because it depends what relationship we have with the supplier. If you are in a weak position, then there is no chance of moving along the chain, because you are in a captive position. I say supplier, but here is the buyer of the oil. If you are in a captive position, your chances of moving along the chain are very slim. So the power structure comes into it. If you are in a position, intermediate position, where you can have some negotiation, you might negotiate some space for improving your capacity, and for, of course, bringing in some products locally made on some service, high level or high level way, technologically high level services. And if you are, of course, in a strong position, then you really negotiate more space where you not only supply only natural resource, but you can resupply equipment. You can even do some of the research locally, because your power position allows you to negotiate broader space in terms of capacity building, in terms of innovation, and in terms of participation into the chain. So this position, power position, is very important. And unfortunately, quite often, when you have a big international firm, corporation, in the oil sector, the local firm has no weight to really negotiate more space than simply supply raw material, natural resources, and oil, whatever, and gas, because the power, negotiating power, bargaining power, is weak. So not everybody can negotiate moving up along the chain if you don't have the right power to do it. That is what I have summarized it, but just put into nice picture. I don't know what, there's some technical problem which occurred. On the design engineering as a driver of innovation, why design engineering? First of all, because within the GlobalX network, we have a research group specifically on design engineering, innovation, and development. So they have been working separately, and the natural resource group is separate. But at one stage, we decided, well, how can we cross-fertilize the knowledge from one research group with the knowledge from the other research group? And this is, we discovered that design engineering, in fact, is a very important component of moving into global value chain, as I said, particularly on non-core activities. So, but we didn't do it out of nothing. There's some work done before us, particularly the work done Martin Bell, which associated to the Globalix network, which shows that design and engineering capacity is crucial industrial driver of industrial innovation and economic development. In other words, you may have national innovation system, you may have all the institutions, but if at the firm level there is no capability of designing and of engineering products in real terms, it doesn't help. So there is a need to have at the core, at the firm level, to develop this core, this design engineering capacity, if the firm wants to move into innovation. And this has been overlooked by so many work done before. If you look at all the work that has been done on national innovation system or innovation at the firm level, I think there are only few limited people who have really attracted the attention to D&E. And so we think that is an important area which has been neglected, which should be rehabilitated into the thinking of innovation and innovation systems. So design engineering is an important stage of innovation capabilities. It often comes from an upgrading process, and I will not be going into depth. It's in my paper. I hope you have read the paper. Through stages, which is part of this moving from natural resources to the end product. And as an example, successful East Asian and Pacific garment manufacturers went from mere assembly to selling and branding their own merchandise, to designing products, selling under their own brand. This is a simple way how to do it. You can only simply sell and then brand, and then you can use your own merchandise, then design, which means you are creative, you innovate, and then, of course, you put your own brand. And in African countries, design for industrial development, as I said, is something neglected. Examining, this is more or less some of the theoretical aspects which I think we have time to do, but it's in more depth in my paper. And I think I have also to watch out for time, but the chairman is here to check me if ever I go a little more over time. But don't worry. Now, having said all that, how did this all translate when you go into the field and you see how this has worked? Has it worked in this way along these terms or what? And what are the chances that... And here we examine the case of Petrobras. Petrobras, what does they produce? Of course, natural resources. Petrol, of course. Petrobras, the major oil-producing company in Brazil, still state-owned, to my understanding, and a giant oil company. We know that in recent times Petrobras has been unfortunately known for many other bad things, but it has done a lot of good things. In spite of all the accusations, I still think Petrobras is a great company. You may disagree, but they have done wonderful things. Petrobras, so a major oil and gas company created a long time ago, 1954. Long before we were born, and managed to enter the successful petroleum equipment and service, GVC, through 14 segments, 14 technologies, which is out of the 30 technologies used, which is almost almost half percent of all the technologies used in the oil equipment have been concerned. This includes semi-submersible. Of course, they are technical terms. Please don't ask me details for the technical terms, because although I know some of them, we may spend the whole morning just explaining what technical term is. So, but you can easily imagine this. We are in the offshore oil production. Okay, it is within the sea, and therefore we see a lot of things to do with submersible. piping and deep water. That explains why these technologies are related to platforms. So we're not in onshore, we are offshore. So semi-submersible platforms, this has platforms which are not stable but are floating, system of valve and instruments, well technology and drilling, control systems. You do a lot of control, remote control, because you don't work easily under the water. So control system imports, multi-phase bumping system, we'll look at them. And it's, in my view, I may be wrong, a rather unique example in the developing world, where through knowledge networks and through proper GVC and penetration strategy, the company could, a developing company could really fully enter into global value chain in its own terms for the production of production export. So just to give you an idea, but I will not be go into all these technologies, that explains exactly what they do. So 14 of them, as I said, semi-submersible, they are summarized here. Semi-submersible platform, systems of valves, just shows you how complicated it can be. It's not only a basic technology, it can be quite sophisticated technologies. Because you might argue, yeah, but they have been in the low end of the technology. No, they have been moving into very sophisticated, up-to-date technology. Pipe carrying oil and gas, that is fairly basic. Umbilicals, data carrying systems, basin analysis and modeling, well technologies, subsea equipment control systems, instrumental pigs, multi-phase pumping system, remote operated vehicles. Vehicles, not with four wheels and you drive. These are vehicles which go under the water. Fixed platform for oil exploration and production, atmospheric wellhead cellars, seismic stratigraphy, analysis method for geological information. Why I went into depth? Because we realized that these technologies don't have the same weight and not the same partners. In some of these technologies, you will note more collaboration with the universities and research centers. In some other technologies, you really more companies, international companies. So all, they require different types of collaboration and different types of partners. The period, as you see, over more than now 50 years, the 60s to 2000s, still going on, the process, so it's a long period. So that means first conclusion, you don't enter a global value chain just within years. It has to be a gradual process and through time. Four stages, four periods, late 60s to 84, 60s, 70s, 85 to 91, 92, 96, and now. And of course, this dynamic approach is also, I probably try to be very brief, to describe this phenomenon in phase one, which started in the 60s up to 84, that was about 20 years. It was simply assimilating acquired methods and technologies, technological accumulation activities, just learning, assimilating. So that's importing technology as much possible and acquiring a lot of knowledge from suppliers, but simply for consumption. So we could call that phase passive learning. You learn, but you don't do much. You just consume it as it is. Nothing is done. And that took, as you see, almost 20 years. So in other words, it's not easy to come out of this dependence on learning. Second phase, which is in 85 to 91, 15 years, they started focusing on specific technologies. So there are 14, but you can't pretend or hope to be integrating all 14 technologies. It has to be a gradual process. You choose which are the more accessible first, and you focus your strategy on a set of limited technologies. This is what they've done, 1, 2, 5, 11, 13, and 14. And that depends on what? That depended on their capacity. Of course, you don't choose this like that. You choose because you feel that you have the right competences and your capacity to do it. So, a greater In this second phase, greater participation in knowledge production. There's more proactive activities. Knowledge flows included flows of more complex design and scientific knowledge. And here, even the members of the employees were more proactive in going to the supplier's premises, learning, getting more training. So absorbing more and more knowledge mean in a proactive way, in a way how to do, to acquire this technology, not simply how to use it, but how actually possibly to adapt it and acquire it differently. We call that phase the active learning. Passive learning, active learning. And then it went on. Then the third phase, which is strengthening already what has been done, but moving into more technologies, that is the consolidation of active learning to establish collaboration with a view to carrying out innovation and build up skills and design skills. You could see here in this third phase, for 4 years, 5 years, the will to really move into not simply absorbing, but producing, but innovating. So at one stage, they felt sufficiently confident to say, okay, now we've been for so many years just absorbing technology. Now, what can we do to really try and innovate and produce it? So that's that stage was characterized by two ways knowledge, bi-directional knowledge design flow between the company and suppliers. In other words, the company, the supplier would supply knowledge, but Petrobras would also supply knowledge to the supplier of equipment. Flows from Petrobras to partners were limited though, and the participation of the company in knowledge production was restricted. This is where the power game comes. Because you don't expect that supplier of equipment to be just passive in front of this growing capability. At one stage, they stop to say, no, you can't move. And you do it through legal, contractual regulations, a whole set of restrictions from legal terms to prevent you from moving to the, because now they are moving to a key element, to a strategic stage where they could actually produce their own equipment, of course, being independent from the supplier. This is where power gain plays very strong. And here, of course, there are a lot of people who are able to move from that stage onwards, and some people who are definitely stopped there and will never move because there is apparatus of legal and terms are so powerful that you just don't go out of it very easily, even if you have money. And this is more and more. So the power game is played. But in spite of that, we call it hybrid stage involving some activity or active learning and preliminary evasion. That means Petrobras was able to negotiate. And this is perhaps it's one of the features which is not common elsewhere. Petrobras was able to negotiate small space of innovation, saying, OK, we respect some of the things, but perhaps in some peripheral technology, can we do something which is not really going into your core? You remain the master. You remain the one who really has monopoly. We just do something on the periphery. Do you allow us? See, this is the way to do it. So they were negotiating a little bit of space for doing some research and development, but certainly not in the core, because the core is protected. This is where, which is, of course, the heart of wealth creation for the company. And, of course, the last stage, which is from the end of 1970s up to 2000 period, the another set of technologies. And here, there are some innovation networks. I think the outstanding thing for Petrobras that it at one stage, it moved not alone. It set up, it integrates some networks who have the same ideas of moving into some segments of equipment. And as a network, they were more able to negotiate with international companies and innovation space. And this, we call it innovation network, and from there, of course, moving to strategic innovation. In this particular stage, the direction of knowledge flows was bidirectional, still the two ways, but we could see something rather unusual, reverse unidirectional flows of complex. At one stage, they had some things which the supplier didn't have of equipment. So they were really being, because they put all the strategy, all the competences, they were able to produce knowledge which the partner didn't have, the big companies didn't have. And they could, because they showed this capacity of producing local knowledge, they become interesting and they become as partners. So there is a reverse, which is very rare. We see it now more and more, but which reverse technology transfer, I would say. Bidirectional flow of complex, and of course, in this stage, the last one is going on. They have joint R&D activities. They have their own research company. They go into reverse technology transfer to supplier, and that they're fully operation to the extent they're exporting oil-producing equipment. For instance, if you look at the competitors now in the Middle East and in Africa, most of these companies, oil companies, are getting their supplies from Brazil rather than from America or from BP, from the UK, which is quite something to outstanding, and which makes this experience fairly successful, because nowhere else you could find a company which went from total passive attitude, only absorbing, right to producing, right to being competitor. And this is, of course, which the companies, international companies, dread the most, because they don't want to build competitors through this way. They'd rather remain in the monopoly. But that shows it is feasible. This is summarized here, of course, designer. And what have we seen? If you look at it clearly and in depth, the thing which has come out. In the passive learning stage, design engineering, basic design. They had some design competencies, but very basic. Basic, that means really looking at how designing the buildings, the batiments, roads, infrastructure, basic design. This is civil engineering. Now everybody can do it. Well, in most countries, this phase, which is the preliminary phase but as we move along, active learning stage, flow of more complex design and scientific knowledge. So right from the start, the beginning, they realized that if you want to go into this global value chain, there is a key function you have to care about and you have to develop, that is design engineering. And because they did it right from the start, they were able to develop it gradually over 50 years, to the extent they are totally autonomous in terms of design. And if you can design your own equipment through your own ideas, through your own research, then you are, of course, totally autonomous and you can compete. So what has come out? That design has been constantly present, either in the passive learning, marginally, but more so in the active learning, and even more in the hub stage, and of course, in the innovation and strategic innovation stage. This is where I set design as a special component, because I believe one of the key successes, one of the components of the success, was really this capacity of design engineering, which you have seen is neglected in most other countries who have tried to go into GVC, but without thinking that they should invest in design. This is one important finding. And of course, it explains how this, and wherever you see, there is a deliberate strategy to go into the GVC. So if we wanted to look briefly at some of the ingredients of success, I think there are many, but in very nutshell, summary. One, first of all, you can't go into a GVC if you don't have first the willingness to go into it. That might be obvious to you, but I can tell you there are a lot of people that were not willing really to go into GVC. they wanted to remain at the last end, just making money, being passive, buying equipment, buying services. Whenever they had problems, they would ring the supplier saying, please, could you come? We have this and this. While they have universities next door, where they have research centers next door, but they have no real political will to do. So to go into GVC, you have first to have the will. And when it's of this magnitude, because these companies are often monopoly and major companies for earning money, at this magnitude, it's a political will. It's not the will of managers. That's not the will at company level. It's really the will at the top political sphere. And this will, and this is a result of the work we have done, it's not often just the same as the will of being going into innovation. But may sound obvious for you today that innovation is a key component. But in spite of that, there are not many decision makers that are aware that right now you can't survive without innovation. And I'm talking from facts because I go surveying the field, talking to decision makers at political level, and I can tell you some of them think it's really not their concern right now. And some of them say, we have a lot of money, why do we want us to innovate? If I want have a problem, then I just pick up my phone and ring such and such company for solving the problem. It's still right now this frame of mind. First, second lesson is focus on one segment of the activity. You don't pretend coming latecomer, because we can call them latecomer firms. You come into this and pretend that going into all aspects of the activity. You have really to be very focused, saying I am going to play this segment of the equipment, as the non-core or the core. Because if you disperse your efforts, you might end up doing nothing. So you really to concentrate on one particular X. And this is what Petrobras did, and right back in the 70s, which is quite rather unusual. Elaborate a clear strategy of GVC over a longer period. In other words, not only you have the willingness, but you also have a vision. This is what we call the vision, saying that, okay, we want, as a Brazil, as Petrobras, by the year 2000, we will be producing our oil equipment. And clearly stated, in the Constitution, in the press, in the media, we want to be producer of our oil equipment. So, vision. So you think in terms of 50 years, you don't think in terms of what we do next 5 years. No, vision, long period. Fourth lesson, use of networking. We are now with the ICT revolution. It's so easy to network because they show a lot of people have the main concern than you. Are there foreign universities? If you see what Petrobras did, they had a whole set of collaborations with foreign universities, for instance, to be able to develop their own competences in France, in the United States, even with competitive companies. And there was a COPE, which is a Brazilian way to do it. It is a higher institute for research and development, applied research and development. You can translate it. So it is this institute, higher institute for research and development, has been involved right at the beginning. And throughout the period, COPE has been accompanying this process. And this is an important aspect, because usually when these companies, either for GVC, for other things, when they want to go into, the knowledge sphere is not evolved. Here, the clever thing to do is to involve what we call the knowledge sphere, local knowledge sphere, but also the international knowledge sphere, right from the beginning. And of course, because this is interactive learning, they help you to develop capacity, but you help them in exchange to develop their capacities. Interactive learning, which is one aspect of the evolutionary thinking of which you know. So that is also one something. And last, of course, is, as I said, develop a strong design engineering R&D capabilities. This is also another lesson. So what I suggest, perhaps stop here, because we have already so many elements. And if time allows, I go to the second leg. That's it.
All right. Good morning, everyone. This is Yelena Vorobey and my wonderful colleague, Laura Bolivar. And today we're going to have a small presentation on the presented paper. So we will talk mainly about two big things. First, we'll have a brief summary and explanations of the main findings, such as global commodity value chain, natural resource sectors, design and engineering activities. And then we'll move into debatable dimensions, including interdependency of proposals and constructive critics and questions. So originally, this paper that we read was actually presented for a conference, so a lot of concepts were just mentioned and not explained in detail. So we thought we were making a lot of value added explaining everything. Good. But in fact, in the presentation by Professor Djeflat, it was already explained. Nevertheless, we go a little bit more in detail, so it might be interesting for everyone. So to start with, global commodity value chain, what is it? It's a pattern of global interaction in which least developed countries can enter a global value chain and use participation to upgrade knowledge base in all sectors. So that's a pretty difficult definition, and it includes a lot of different notions. So let's consider them one by one. First, global value chain. It's a chain that describes the full range of activities that firms and workers perform to bring a product from its conception to end use and beyond. So here is an example, but in fact, typical chains include much more segments, including the production of each raw material, product design, packaging, storage, processing, assembly, marketing, and distribution. So each segment normally includes one or more companies that are often placed in different countries. The GVC analysis actually helps you to understand this interconnected network of relationships through mapping actors' relationships within each segment. There are four dimensions that are very important to understanding this framework, which is called input-output structure. It helps you to explain the production flow and the industry evolution. The geographical scope, which identifies the allocation decisions for lead and following firms. Institutional context, which explains the different economic, social, and political policies and how it affects on chain participants. And governance, which analyzes the relationships in case of unequal power context. This is the governance schedule.
Thank you.
Yeah, this I think this is exactly the graph that you're missing. So that's good that now we can present it.
Beautiful, isn't it?
All right, so this is a governance mechanism. It's normally separated on five different types, depending on the complexity of information, codification process, and supplier competence. So here, the simplest form is the market structure, in which case the transactions are governed by the market price. There is a limited the market power of different parties, and the switch between different parties is quite simple. On the opposite side, you see the hierarchical structure, which is the most integrated structure where everything is basically led by the lead firms. And this is in cases when the transaction transformation of knowledge and the transmitting of knowledge is quite difficult, the products are complex, or there are lack of competent suppliers. In the middle, you have three other forms. First is modular governance. This is in case when suppliers adjust for specific customer specifications. There is relational governance, in which case there is a long-term relationship between suppliers and customers. And there is captive governance, in which there is a strong buyer who exercises control over less competent suppliers. So another important concept is industrial upgrading. It's moving from exploitation of natural resources to manufacturing, packaging, distribution, and branding. So if we imagine the global value chain as a ladder, that would be climbing the ladder. In fact, there are four different types of upgrading. Product upgrading, which is moving to more sophisticated products. Process upgrading, more efficient production and technologies. Intrasectoral upgrading, acquiring new functions within the same chain. Or intersectoral upgrading, this is taking the competences from one chain and applying it to the other. However, as any economic activity, participation in global value chain has its positive and negative sides. And among the positive sides are increased employment, deepened industrial structure, opportunities for lateral migration, technological exchange, and competition. However, there are also the downsides, which are mostly the social factors that can be summarized as chase to the bottom. In this case, the developing countries are trying to become more attractive and offer lower costs, which in a sense can hurt the different social factors and end up in poor working conditions, inequality, power asymmetry, and undesirable social changes. However, in both cases, there is lack of empirical evidence, and we still don't know which of those benefits or downsides is more prevailing. So now let's move to natural resource-based growth. Natural resources are materials or substances that occur in nature which can be exploited for economic gain. So it's a very generic definition. However, in the paper, mostly oil and gas sectors are described. However, it's not only limited to that. Natural resource economy, therefore, is an economy with natural resources having a prevalent role in economic development. And the paper states that it's possible to move from dependence on natural resources to more diversified and a knowledge-based economy shown by Scandinavian countries. And so basically it contrasts the two different cases. The first one is Dutch disease, or Dutch case, in which there is over-reliance on extracting sector, which has consequently led to dying out of other sectors, or the cases of Finland and Norway, which is a more balanced growth spreading to different sectors. So how did they do that? And the answer is the learning curve. So as you know, manufacturing has increasing returns to scale. So it takes some time to learn, but once they learn, that for each unit of input, the output is much greater. And it's done through forward and backward linkages. Forward linkages, if you're developing your industry, the other industries that using your output develop. And backward linkages are, if you develop your industries, the industries that provide input to yours develop. So as a result, you see the accumulation of knowledge. And with some synergy, it becomes possible to move up the value chain that you're already present, or to move to other value chains, or the value chains of non-core activities.
Okay, so now I will talk about the...
If you want to see them.
The design and engineering activities, as the clear objective of the first paper, was to demonstrate how innovation processes open possibilities for Africa specifically, and in order to participate in the global value chain through the strengthening of this type of activities. So Professor Djeflat explains three conceptions. They are capabilities boosting innovation. They are also a crucial driver for economic growth, and they explain the technological gap in Africa because Africa tends to outsource them. And also they are at the core of science, technology, and innovation systems, especially in advanced industrialized economies. But what are the consequences of these conceptions? First, that they interact mainly with the institutional setup by pooling some training and education, you said that. And also the structure of production by pushing some investments and changes. Then they are also an opportunity for African producers to integrate the global value chain and so improve the local capacities. And then they are built through effective learning processes, and also they are met and improved by the complexity of the technology. So now we would like to enrich these conceptions by proposing a clear definition and delimitation of the design and engineering activities. So these authors, Yersem and Cross, they say that they are knowledge-intensive processes, and they are planned in a sequential way, as we see from the graph. So on design of design activities, we have a task. Then this task has to be specified through some essential problems and technical functions. Then it has to be consolidated in a concept with some selection of methods and materials that will satisfy technical and economic criteria. And finally, after an engineering analysis of the errors and cost effectiveness of this concept, then the layout is modified. Now we go to the engineering activities, and this is mainly all the technical and operational requirements for the production planning and the production management. Okay, for the interdependency of proposals, what we are going to do is to present some aspects of the initial paper that have been stated by other authors, and in this way, they are in open discussion. One of them is the brain drain in Africa, which is one of the main obstacles for the improvement of design and engineering capabilities, and also they justify the lack of innovative contributions for the African economy as a whole. So relevant literature contributes with these four main facts. The first one is that since 1990, Africa has been losing 20,000 highly skilled professionals per year. The second one is the annual remittances. They exceeded the foreign aid and investment inflows. Then we have that the highly skilled professionals, they not only carry the past investments, meaning that the investments done for their education, but also future revenues, talking about the potential contributions to the African economy. And finally, brain drain not only hinders innovation, but also reduces the quality of social services and prevents the institutional setup. So now, as a consequence, we have that Africa only have three main strategy alternatives for turning the brain drain into brain gain. They are retention, the incentives to return, or the diaspora benefits. The diaspora benefits is the construction of networks abroad that will try to improve the local development. But Maharaj, this is an author, he says that there is a possible mitigation of brain drain if it doesn't exceed 20% of the highly skilled population in a country. But what to do in countries like Kenya, or Ghana, or Mozambique, or Tanzania, in which one-third to half of the highly skilled population already emigrated? The second aspect is related to the limited capacities of Africa to innovate in natural resources sectors. And this is mainly because Professor Djeflat states that leading firms somehow try to obstaculize the design and engineering improvement in order to keep their leadership. So we have also the deficit of engineers and weak national innovation systems. So in order to understand the causes for all these situations, we have constructed this table. It contains the science, technology, and innovation national policies for several African countries. And what we see from here is that, of course, the main objective is not the development of design and engineering capabilities, but the transfer of technologies. There is also a dominance of sectoral policies, with the exception of South Africa, which has a horizontal policy. Some of the prioritized sectors are education, agriculture, and health. And there is no fostering of industry-university-state relations. And finally, one of the main weaknesses is that there is an inability to go or to do the transition from policy formulation to policy implementation. And this may explain somehow the poor outcomes. So now, Yelena will explain a good example of Africa in which an SDI policy has influenced in a good way national industry.
Thank you. So now let's consider one example from Africa which is considered to be successful. It's case of Ethiopia cut flower industry. So to have some background about Ethiopia, it's a low-income country, it's landlocked, it has bad neighborhood with Sudan and Somalia, it's the second largest population in Africa, and it has the fastest economic growth among African countries in the recent years. So the policy that they implemented was industrial policy that we discussed in yesterday's June seminar. Reciprocal control mechanism, it's basically when the government provides funds under certain conditions, and the conditions has to be met by the companies. If they're not met, the funds are revoked. And infant industry development. The main drivers of development were foreign investment, government support, political transformation, infrastructure improvement, innovation in transport and storage technologies. So cut flower industry is a very labor-intensive industry which has the possibility to employ a big amount of people. So basically how it's done, the flowers are grown on the farms. Then they're cut, they're put to special refrigerators, and they are sent to the nearby local airports, and then they're shipped all over the world. And actually, this is a much more, let's say, higher priced, cut flower is much higher priced than the typical agricultural production. So as a consequence, we see the development of Ethiopian Airlines, which is becoming more popular in Africa, linkages to horticulture and cement industry, which started developing on the good example of cut flower, increased investment, both local and international, sectoral growth, high exports, accumulation of technological capabilities. So in this case, although it's not specifically natural resources per se, however, it's a successful case of transformation to knowledge assets.
Okay, now we begin with the part of the constructive critics, which are placed in the form of questions in order to understand the logic behind them. So the first one is related to Petrobras as a case study, because in the original paper we see these integration stages, and as you can see, all of them involve networks. So our question is, why have not you developed explicitly a network analysis, including a clear identification of involved actors besides COPE or COPE or COPPE, their main interests and a priori conditions and power relations. Mm. Then the second related question is that, considering that many dimensions of these learning processes mean to move from one stage to another, these learning processes hold tacit knowledge. So why the role of knowledge externalities generated from these network interactions is not explicitly discussed or explained? And in fact, we would like to know how did suppliers and partners benefit from these interactions besides the bidirectional flows of knowledge? And the next question is regarding your conception of the engineering role in the global value chain and natural resources sectors, because you have underlined the role of industrial and civil engineering, because you've said that Africa has a lack of industrial engineering because it hasn't facilitated the entry to global value chain. And in the case of civil and construction engineering, it needs more development because Africa needs better providing of equipment and infrastructure. But of course, industrial engineers do.
Excuse me.
The industrial engineers do more. They are in charge of the process of optimization, the plant design, project management, and also the civil and construction engineering. They do more, like environmental projects and also management. So our concern is, why is there a special focus in these two types of engineering and in these two tasks specifically? Since for any industry, the inter- and multidisciplinary engineering work is highly relevant. And talking about, for example, the natural resources sectors or the oil industry, the chemical engineering also is very important, or the environmental and even the petroleum engineering. Okay, this question is regarding the type of innovation, because on one hand, for the technological capabilities in the original paper, no? Innovation is understood as entirely new products and processes. But then for design and engineering activities, we have that innovation is the upgrade of design interpretations. So why are not organizational innovations considered? And why are radical and incremental innovations assigned in advance to a specific capabilities? Because of course, innovation is also the outcome of dynamics in a day-to-day basis. And then this question is regarding D&E and R&D, because in the original paper, during the theoretical background, you have said that design and engineering activities are more important than R&D, or it seems to be understood like that. And the empirical section, talking about Petrobras, they are just understood as the same activities. So according to you, what are the similarities and differences among them, and why are not they explicitly seen as complementary?
All right, and the last set of questions first is about knowledge assets. As was mentioned before, the Ethiopian cat flower industry, although not the natural resources, but it might present a successful case of upgrading using local capabilities and national innovation systems. So according to you, which factors made this case different, and would it be possible to ensure a similar conversion of global value chain participation into knowledge assets for other African countries? Another question concerns upgrading. In the paper, it stated that there are some dynamics of the governance pattern. So if we remember the graph with the five different types, there's supposed to be dynamics towards the more free, of the firms having more capacities. So which are actually the driving elements of such dynamics and change of power structures? And finally, let's think about social effects. The globalization of innovation process helps to move up the chain. However, are there any negative sides about it? Are there any downsides? And can they be avoided? So here is the list of our references. And thank you all for attention.
So, who is going to talk now? Me or whom? Ah, okay. Yes, oh my God. I'm not sure I have an answer. Well, first of all, well done, congratulations. Very good. Very good work. In fact, I learned some of the things. One of the framework, which you knowledge externality is interesting. I wasn't aware of it, so that you helped me to improve the paper. As I said earlier, it is a paper in the making. Of course, it's not a definite thing which you have done. But this certainly, I think, perhaps an area where we haven't seen much work done in linking the three components. National Innovation System, that is building capacity innovation. GVC, Global Value Chain, and Design Engineering. I don't know whether in your research you've come across all that. But if you take two major works, that is Gerifi and Kaplinsky, which is one of the leading works, and the second most important one is Rabelotti and Pitirubilli, which you haven't mentioned. That is one key work. If you took those two papers, then you have practically summarized all what has been done in this area so far. And so if you look at the literature review, there isn't that much elements. And that's why I think, hopefully, bringing these three together is a little, putting a little stone into the building of that wall. Although, as I said, trying to transcribe this in empirical terms. Because if you look at the work of Petrobelli and Arbelotti, two Italian researchers, very well known, members of the GlobalX, they have magnificent work on, in terms of theoretical terms, drawing from the work done earlier by Lal, Sanjaya Lal, the people who know the capability issues, is one of the landmarks in terms of capability building in developing world. And in fact, Abdelkader was, Petrobelli was a student of Sanjaya Lal. And so all that old tradition of building capabilities comes from a long time. But when it came to this engineering issue, design and engineering and global value chain, they brought a lot of theoretical concepts. And I draw, I must admit, I draw from some of their work, but still insufficiently research in the field. The illustration is still very rare in this area. So I must admit. Second thing, these are also some of the limitations of the paper. And you pointed out a very important point. The networking. Yes, indeed. I could have approached it through network analysis. But as the focus was on GVC, networking was for me only one tool of strategy, and strategic tool how to do it. It's not the network which is the objective. I mean, Petrobras could have done something else if it used some other strategy. It used network to some extent. To some extent it used network because, which is a clever way of doing it, because networks could overcome some of internal and external learning. There's a lot of learning which has to be mobilized, and you can't do learning on your own. You have to really to draw into networks to bring, update at least your knowledge through collaboration. For instance, a lot of cooperation with, as I say, foreign universities, for instance. That is the soft end of the global value chain. But on the other hand, there was a hard end, which is negotiating with BP, with Schlumberger, with all the major construction companies. And that was a really hard negotiating with the suppliers of equipment. And that was an easy game. And sometimes it has to, that's why it took so much time, because there was a lot of convincing. But I agree, I also raised the question, let's, we have to draw the limitations. Because on the other hand, if you look at the developing world, including Latin America, which I expect are the more advanced in terms along this thinking, there isn't much work done when you come to think on GVC in natural resources and how you can penetrate. So this is, and I said it in my paper, to some extent we consider it as a proxy. I stress, underline the word. It is a proxy. And as a proxy, it has its limitations. And well done for having pointed out to that point, because this is a weakness, indeed. But on the other hand, there's so much lessons to be learned that the networking, as I said, wouldn't harm the lessons which we have drawn from. Because the network is a strategy. You do it through networking. But that doesn't mean the end result is what? Because when you think in terms of whole analysis, what is the end result? The end result that Petrobras, starting from being a simple consumer, a passive consumer of external knowledge for 20 years, to a competitor into selling now a new, brand new equipment, which it engineered. If this is not penetrating global value chain, what would you call it? This is really right into global value chain. So, you know, the fact, we say the proof of the pudding is in the eating, people who know the British. You know it. The proof of the pudding is in the eating. It's in the end that you have to assess the whole thing. Okay, that's just to excuse a little bit myself. Knowledge externalities, there are a lot of externalities. I mean, I haven't had time to, it's true, I could have perhaps talked a little more on knowledge externalities, but the fact that this knowledge, linkages with knowledge, external sources of knowledge, has allowed Petrobras to develop externalities, not only in terms of diffusion of knowledge to COP, because as I said, COP has been instrumental into developing that, but also in a whole set of subcontractors, which have been locally mobilized to accompany Petrobras. I haven't talked much about this. Small SMEs who have been gradually being brought in to produce a little component which was needed for such and such equipment. The hundreds. So externalities in Italy were very important because it brought some other. That's why, in fact, there was internal networks, but also external networks. And externalities, that requires another another detailed analysis of what the externalities were, and it's possibly it's something which further research. I would say there should be a ground for another article or another thesis. If you are interested, then I can can put you on that. There are some questions which probably I didn't quite get. I'll come. The third one wasn't very clear to me. But because you are so quick, could take everything.
If I may explain that to you again.
Third one, yeah.
Yeah.
You were the one who presented it.
Yeah. So this is regarding your conception of the engineering role along the global value chain and the natural resources sectors, because during the original paper, you have underlined the role of industrial engineering and civil engineering. Why industrial engineering? Because you've said that it is absent in Africa because it hasn't facilitated the entry into the global value chain. And also that civil engineering needs more development because it hasn't provided the proper equipment and infrastructure for the natural resources sectors. So, but of course the industrial engineering is broader, no? They do process of optimization, plan design, project and logistics management, and also the civil engineering. They do management and environmental projects. So the question is actually, why is there a special focus in these two types of engineering, and especially in these two tasks? Because when talking about natural resources sectors and oil industry, then the multidisciplinary engineering work is very important. Mm. And for example, the chemical engineering plays a crucial role. Mm. Or let's say the petroleum engineering, and also we can think about the environmental engineering. So is it more clear now?
It's clearer. I was quite clear to what extent. The argument in the paper is, of course, both are important. Because it's already a first step towards GVC, global value chain. So both are important. But what happened is to what extent can you really move into that direction? For instance, you are mentioning about petrochemicals. Yes, petrochemicals, it is being done locally in many areas. As I said, no, we seem to be in an era. If you see the number of petrochemical complexes which are bought in the world by the Middle East, Africa, and thousands are being, because everybody realizes. But that is almost how much involvement of the local competences and the local knowledge networks internally, they still remain very marginal, if only if it is multidisciplinary. So my concern is not whether you move along the chain and you are actually, or instead of selling raw materials, you do some processing locally to produce petrol. For instance, there's a lot of refining as well. Those two directions which are these companies are moving, refining and petrochemicals, they're doing very well. But when you look at it, how much of real penetration into GVC and how much they are capable of reproducing that locally, that's very difficult. What they can do in most countries, look at Nigeria, look at Saudi Arabia, look at Algeria, look, these countries, now more or less they have been able to do the first step. That's why, if time allowed, I would show you perhaps the next, because the next paper, the next bit, respond to some of this. They've been able to enter fairly successfully in civil and construction engineering in that sector, okay? The only problem they have is when the intensity of work, when they want to do, to produce, to construct, let's say, so many oil pipes, drill so many wells, etc. The sheer amount of work brings them to resort to a supplier, because the internal capacity is there, but is not sufficient. So it's lack of sufficient capacity internally, which is the obstacle. It's not their capacity. They're quite capable of building roads, of building, of setting pipes, of oil exploration, a lot. For instance, we take Algeria in the 1980s. Out of 30 exploration wells, drilling, 1980s, 70s, 80s, beginning of 1990s. Out of 30 wells, exploration, successfully exploration, because you do a lot of exploration, it doesn't lead anywhere. 28 were done by foreign companies. Okay? So even in oil exploration, there was no prospect for them to moving. Simple oil exploration. So we are really at the very beginning of the value chain. Not production, not distribution, not marketing. We're at the very end, exploration, 1980s. Now, comparative terms. Out of 30 wells successfully achieved, 28 are done locally, only two through international companies. This is a clear example. So how they moved from one dependent situation totally on the foreign companies, on the supplier, right to being able to transform, to do the work locally, that is oil services, because they still don't produce the equipment for oil drilling. They only do the service. And this is one of the achievements of Petrobras, because Petrobras said, quite early, now we are able to draw holes to bring oil out of the ground. But when you look at this equipment, finally, it's not that sophisticated. Why can't we do this equipment? Which, when you practically, is only a pipe with a drilling head, and we call it Christmas tree. You take it into the ground and it's simple. But that very simple action hasn't been thought around in many other countries. They still think to bring this drilling equipment, you still have to go Schlumberger, you still have to go to such and such company. So you see, that just to tell you that it's not easy to move from one situation, but now what we are seeing, that end of drilling holes, of building the roads, or building the holes, because they need to be built, of housing construction, that seems to have been clearly within the grasp. That first stage of the global chain is now, I think, beyond now, has grown beyond expectation. Everybody can do it. But now, moving from there into real industrial engineering means that building the refinery, building the equipment for transportation, building. That is something which is, which the capacity accumulated earlier is not sufficient. And yes, I agree for that. In that second stage, multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary engineering is relevant, but in the ground, it is not there. So my idea is right now how you can use that capacity, that knowledge, internally generated and externally to some extent, how can you use to go from the state to the second stage, industrial engineering? See? So that is really the argument. Organizational innovation and incremental, yes, they are very important because I mean, we don't consider, and this is right back to the definition of innovation from Schumpeter, 1, 2, 3, because Schumpeter has got three stages, not only one. He has three stages, Mark 1, Mark 2, Mark 3. And all the evolutionary thinking. And who says evolutionary thinking? The mecca of evolutionary thinking, the heart of evolutionary thinking is Globalix. Because all the evolutionary thinkers are there in Globalix. So we are really in the front of evolutionary thinking. It keeps. We have Dick Nelson, we have Lundvall, we have all the thinkers, we have Luc Sowety, all the people who have been constructing evolutionary thinking in technical change are there. And of course, it is an interactive process. In other words, you can't possibly have technological innovation or technical progress if at the same time the institutional setup and the organizational setup is not, of course, innovating and progressing. And you agree, this is also something which I should bring in the future. How much of that organizational innovation has gone into, because a tremendous amount has gone into going gradually from the raw material situation, the early stage, right to the producing equipment. A lot of thinking, a lot of organizational. For instance, the network with the universities, how much university, what contract they, how could you motivate researchers to work into specific areas, for instance. That has gone, reviewing contract, reviewing all the status of researchers, full-time researchers, reviewing all the laws, salaries, schemes, pensions, why, how can you prevent people with clear, and it links up to what you said later, I will come back, to the diaspora. Because, and you have really quite rightly pointed out to something very, in fact, it's not because there wasn't capability building over the years. It's capacity building. Whenever it reached a certain level, it just vanished. Because they become then, in the world market, very important people, key people to recruit. So they will go. Nigeria is one of the good examples, but Algeria and the others. So diaspora is one of the key issues. So they've been building it. And they, because the very lack of organizational and institutional innovation. You can't keep somebody in there in the premises without looking at the rule for salary, for pension, for schemes, for housing. You use the old setup, institutional framework. You don't innovate. So this agent, in terms of technical and scientific, he has been growing, but its environment has been there, hasn't moved. And this is what explains diaspora. People think they are too broad, too competent for that particular setup. They're not well housed. Salaries are not, pensions, conditions of work, etc., etc. So that's why, to prevent this from happening, Petrobras went into a lot of institutional innovation, working closely with the COP to motivate researchers in terms of salaries, pensions, etc., but also with the government. Petrobras was a member of what you call a think tank, funded BNDES. BNDES is a national bank. Brazilians know it, has played fundamental role into the capacity of science, technology, and innovation in Brazil right now, to the extent, in fact, that some of the members of Globalix are counselors now at BNDES, if you are. Yelena Lastre, if you want the literature. Yelena Lastre, he's a member of Globalix. She is the wife of José Cassiolato, if you want me to give all the history, private of José Cassiolato is the current Secretary General of Globalix. He's in Rio de Janeiro. And Yelena Lastre has done a lot of work trying to bring some awareness that there should be a national system of innovation. For 30 years she has been doing that. But now she's recruited at government level as advisor to the BNDES. So that linkage between research fair, companies, and institutional was there and was, of course, the object of a lot of creativity, innovation to overcome. That's why one of the conclusions, if you remember, I thought I said that one of the key successes is to involve the knowledge sphere at the early stage, not when you have already. For instance, there are attempts now by other companies, and I am my second part of the paper, which you haven't got. okay, it's about Sonatrach. What is Sonatrach? Sonatrach is a big oil company in Algeria, 12th company in the hierarchy, 120,000 workers, and so 12th company and the first company in Africa, in terms of strength, in terms of capacity, in terms of income, up to $75 billion in terms of income, and major contributor to the economy. But the knowledge sphere hasn't been involved. It's only lately, in the year 2000, when it became clear that the oil and oil wealth wouldn't last, is not sustainable, they have been resorting to universities saying, okay, let's discuss this. But look how many years, because Sonatrach was created shortly after Petrobras. Petrobras in 54, Sonatrach in 63. Not that long. Look where Petrobras is, supplying equipment to Sonatrach. Major oil equipment are supplied by Petrobras. And yet they started almost at the same time, because the knowledge sphere hasn't been involved at all, or has been involved very lately. Secret is that. So that very fact that knowledge sphere is involved, that you have to review everything which is of a natural, of organizational type. And indeed, it requires another section in the paper where we should look at what has been done in terms of organizational sphere, and in terms of financing also. Financing has been a key of it. How can you finance it? Because bearing in mind, in both cases, these are state companies. And so they can't go easily on the capital market. They can't go easily in the security market. They can't go easily into borrowing for the international. They have to go through the state monopoly. Okay? And yet, one has been able to innovate within that same constraint. No, there wasn't. That's why I said the next pact was very important. And sorry, I'm talking too much. cut flowers, yeah, fantastic example. I was tempted to talk about it also, but it is the usual example, which is thanks for wanting to. This is one of the success stories: cut flowers in and wine in South Africa. It's another success story, how South Africa went from pure consumer and of equipment for the whole wine GVC. Now South Africa is producing all the equipment, not only the wine, but also all the equipment which are necessary to produce wine and distill it and etc. So it has been integrating upstream, as we call it. So another example, if you have time to look at it, wine in South Africa, but there are, of course, shrimps in Chile, and I can go telling you how much, there's so many stories. Okay. But just one. yes, the design engineering is more important than R&D. No, I am not saying that. You can design engineering. No, why I put design engineering? It's a deliberate emphasis, just to show that design engineering is a neglected area in the national innovation system. So far, nobody has given attention to design engineering. Thanks to the work of our good old friend, Martin Bell, who was commissioned by IDRC in 2005, he was commissioned by IDRC to do specific study how, because in fact design engineering, what happened to it, it was a key issue back in the 70s. That's the strange thing about it. If you look at the history of thinking of science, technology, and innovation, in the 70s, everybody, just as much as the transfer of technology. The first book I wrote it in the 70s. My first book was Transfer in Technology and Industrial Development. You can find it on the. And in there, I was talking at that about design engineering. But then that died out, as it was structural adjustment, dominance of market, international markets, the state withdraws back to regulation, and the like. Design engineering just vanished. And nobody ever talked about design engineering. For almost 25 years, it disappeared. And yet, when you look at it, when you look at all success stories, you find it as being a key element. And I don't know whether you saw it in my paper, or maybe I put it in another paper. The gap in terms of D&E. Okay, we say there is a gap, and you know, the ICT gap, etc. The gap in D&E is much bigger than the gap in R&D between the advanced countries and developing countries. So if you look at innovation indices, and you look, you see there is a broad gap by all standards, either the World Competitiveness Report, the GWE, Global Innovation Index, or other indexes, you see there is a gap between, of course, developed and developing countries. But if we study the gap, and this I put it as a theme, if I don't know whether anybody, that is a very fascinating story. The gap is a lot bigger, because simply nobody. That's why, in fact, I stressed the line, as I say, just to say that it is perhaps more important, but it is as important. In other words, if you want to have a national innovation system, innovation strategy, you want to set up your R&D, but you simply ignore or leave D&D out in terms of industrial development. And I also invite you to look at the work of Roderick on industrial development, which has been very outstanding for these last years. You could see Roderick also has pointed out to the necessity of rethinking design engineering. Then you see how much if you do a national innovation system without even one word on D&E. This is just theoretical. You are theoretical. You can do all the beautiful national innovation system designed by the world experts. But if that dimension is out, then it remains just a theoretical framework. You will not move into the industrial development. So this is why I put so much emphasis on it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Merci. Sorry, there are so many other questions, but apparently we have to listen to the other colleagues.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nationalistic approach, because Petrobras was founded in the nationalistic government and the military government.
No,
it doesn't work. Okay.
Ah, okay. Sorry. I thought it was for.
But anyway, just including also a nationalistic perspective towards petroleum as a priority. And I have two questions. One is, in a first approach, I would put your third and fourth phases a bit earlier, because I was like searching on the internet now, and I remember like offshore technology was a challenge to Petrobras since the 80s. And it actually, COPI was founded in 1963, CEPETRO, which is at Unicamp, was founded in 1987, so they were already joint R&D activities. And then PROCAP, which is the program put in place to develop this technology, was in 1986. And in 1992, the company actually won an award for the development on offshore technology.
1992.
So maybe, I don't know, from a first approach, I would put those phases a bit earlier.
Okay, good. Yeah.
And then
good.
Just the last question really quick. The company has put in place now a divestment program, and I just wonder...
A divestment program.
So it's divestment. It's decreasing its investment and actually selling assets. Do you think this threatens its place as a reference in technology in the oil industry?
Okay. Good questions. Shall I react immediately? Immediately. Okay. Okay. It's up to you.
I have taken the microphone. Sorry. Okay. Yeah. Just a short question. Do you know any successful case when an oil and gas company, for example Petrobras, has entered a global value chain on the stage of distribution by means of innovative activities? Because this is not usually a case. I don't know too much about Petrobras, but I know a bit about Gazprom in Russia.
Yeah,
they still invest a lot in the pipes, traditional pipes, because it's easier to build a pipe and to use to bargaining power to take control over this pipe by creating a joint enterprise or whatever. Mm-hmm. But they are not investing too much in the innovative means of distribution. That's the question.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So Elena, and then we take a few answers. And
Thank you very much for your presentation. It was very interesting. And you spoke at the beginning very briefly about Global X and about objectives. My question would be, the first question would be, how objectives would differ in if we go through our regions, like in Asia, in Europe, how they would differ, especially if we compare developing and developed countries. And the second question would try to broaden this discussion.
Can you repeat the first one?
Because yes.
I don't seem to have picked it.
Okay,
up
because you presented the case, not the case, Globalix. Yes.
Yeah.
And you said that there are different branches.
Yes, true.
Within these branches, you did not define different objectives for different branches, but you just presented global objectives.
Yeah.
And my question would be, what's the difference in these targets and objectives if we compare these branches, and especially in developing and developed countries?
Yeah.
And for the second questions, do you believe that it's particularly important to develop and diffuse oil and gas technologies within, for instance, newly industrialized countries, emerging countries? For instance, if we speak about countries with really diffused rural areas, with islands or with some rural cities, do you think that it's important for them to acquire technology from developed countries, oil and gas technology, or they should focus more on sustainable development technologies? I like to discuss this topic. So, this would be my question.
Good.
Thanks.
Good. Okay. Is it, that's it? Okay.
You can
take
another round of questions.
No.
Yes.
I have my okay, if I understood right. First, yes, thank you. You said three questions or two? Three.
One comment.
I would say thank you, because the work on Petrobras is not my work. I said I draw from Dantas and Bell, and I'm not stealing anybody's. Particularly, both are my friends, so I can't do that to them. I really said, and perhaps you haven't read, if you read the paper, I said I draw heavily from the work done by Dantas and Bell. So it is as good as what Dantas and Bell put forward. If there are mistakes in the periodization, thank you for correcting, but I will tell. Yes, it's good. Could you bring? Maybe things happen differently. But Dantas is a Brazilian, well-known, famous researcher. Eva Dantas, who doesn't know Eva Dantas? She. So, Eva Dantas is a brilliant Brazilian researcher, and Martin Bell is a giant, as true. I mean, both in terms of size, he measures almost 2 meters, but also in terms of thinking. So I trust they do good work, and this work is in the International European Journal of Science and Technology. You could find the reference in the paper. So, yeah, I agree. But if I have the opportunity to tell them, I certainly. I'm giving a lecture at SPRU, and on the 3rd of February, and you know who is discussant of my paper? Martin Bell himself. So I will convey the message to him and keep you informed. I'll keep you informed what he thinks. Okay. Divestment program, yes, true. I mean, the following the crisis, the various crises which Petrobras has gone through, there has been some problems in terms of course, you know the corruption aspect of it, the lack of confidence with the government, withdraw some of the support in some activities, the political crisis itself, because it has strong support under the Lula regime, and of course in the following era. So that withdrawal of support has, and I was talking to my good Brazilian friends, and they said, we have been going through troubled times because we have been doing all that, because permanently the government, successive governments, since Cardoso, who is the first president. So that is, for 40 years they have had that support, 30 years. But now with the corruption, with some, and unfortunately because of some of this financial crisis, do you know which are the activities which have been suffering? And that's unfortunate. In Petrobras. All the R&D centers have been closed. That is, I think, the most of them have been either budget cut, or closed with researchers going as well. Okay, this is what my friends tell me. Donc, it's true, divestment because of this political crisis, which, in my view, but this is the current mistake many governments in developing world do. Whenever there is fall in oil prices, they go cut down into the essential things, less research, less marketing, less, whereas these are, and less innovation into organization. But this true divestment, will affect this, which will be a pity. Not all of it, because some of it now it's internalized, completely internalized. So it means even if they don't have a relationship with partners, they can do it locally. But to what extent the divestment is going to affect, certainly will affect. But these have to be, you're talking about the experience of Russia, is that so? And your argument is, it is important to go into the distribution stage, or the distribution stage is just... Yeah, just as important. In fact, this is the soft end of, as I said, of, for instance, whenever there was some capacity, there was no major objective to letting the local distribution taking over from the GVC. Simply because local distribution, that is pipes. It's a lot easier to have local industry making pipes to distribute than bringing boats full of pipes from Russia to Tanzania. Imagine, a lot of air transported.
But there was recently a technology of liquefied gas.
Yes.
But in order to receive this gas, the host country, the target country, should have a terminal.
Yeah.
Really costly to build.
Yes.
So again, costs are higher than...
Yeah, but this is in the sphere. So there are stages in the global value chain which has been easily let to oil-producing countries because it doesn't have the core. It doesn't have. But that means that doesn't mean that these countries are capable of building a terminal or gas liquefying complex. I know the example, I know it at least in Saudi Arabia, I know it also in Algeria. They've been commissioning gas liquefying complexes, that is, you know, for how many? I think the program started in the 80s. So 80 to now, that's what, we have 30 years, 40 years. Right now, only recently, they ordered for another gas liquefying plant. And you know, they bought it turnkey. Mm. Nothing is learned. Turnkey. You know what turnkey contract? Mm. You don't know thing. Just the same as they did it 30 years ago. Okay? But they can distribute, they can. So it depends. If you don't go into the core activity, then we go to the figure. Which friends showed, which shows that the negotiation can be easily because you are not going into the core. Even if you do it at a distance, there is no integration that is distant, and you can in the distribution. So yes, I agree. In the distribution, you can move easily because you are not going into the core. And that, why we go back again to the Petrobras? Because Petrobras hasn't been kept in the periphery. Of the activity, it has actually got into the heart of the activity, and that is something rather unique. Okay. Okay. Back to yes, for Global X. Of course, I didn't want to stay to spend more time on Global X, and okay, could have gone for 2 hours explaining what Global X is. Yes, indeed, the very fact that Global X diversified, it could have been one big single organization run from Aalborg. I was in Aalborg 2 days ago, again, because I am a member of Scientific Board. But we realized that the concerns are not the same. If you looked at Asia, and for instance, just give you an example, and this is a paper I wrote, it's in my website. I find it. If you look at the idea of catching up, the idea of catching up, who wants now to catch up with leading countries? Asian countries. So AGLX, India, South Korea, we have scholars from that particularly. Their dreams, how to catch up America, how to be as good as the Americans. It's not the same thing with somebody from Ethiopia or with Chad. It's not his concern to catch America. So really to get things basic, to get food, to get sustainable growth. Mm-hmm. So the same are not the same concerns. So that means you have to set up a branch who cares for catch up, and we have another branch in Africa, which is called emergence. How they emerge from nothing. Whereas the Koreans, Ken Lee, I don't know whether you know the literature, one of the leading scholars, member of the scientific board, Ken Lee, C-K-E-U-N, Lee, L-E-E, leading scholar, Ken Lee, all his papers with Dick Nelson, almost a Nobel Prize, they all catch up. They are producing about five books with their colleagues. You could find them on the website on catch up. But that has no...
Ken Lee has been supervising one of the students of EPOG last year.
Ah, is it? Ah, well, good, great man, yeah, great. You should invite him, but... is more than Lille. It's a good friend. So you see, so we had to, of course, if you go to Latin America, they also have specific concern. Mm-hmm. So that's why we at the scientific board, at one stage, it was something we did about 8-9 years, we decided that we definitely need to have branches which tackle specific problems and issues of that particular region. But even if you look at the thematics, the themes, if you go to the GlobalX website, you see all the themes of the conferences ever since we started. As I told you, last year was the 14th conference. We were in Bandung, in Indonesia. They change according to where the conferences are being held. Mm-hmm. If it is held in India, then you see that the dominant theme is about emerging countries, about catching up, about this. If when we held the one in Dakar, it was poverty, alleviation, sustainability, innovation in the informal sector. Mm-hmm. People in Asia don't care about innovation in the informal sector. Whereas in that particular region, there's a lot of innovation being done, but in the informal sector. So we had to effectively adapt local. And of course, for reasons of distance. I mean, it's closer to, it's much easier to work with scholars from region in terms of it costs money to bring all instead of bringing them all. Having said that, there is a major globalist conference which is held every year, and now we are thinking because the rhythm has been so intense, we are thinking in setting it every 2 years. So much money and intensity. And now the secretariat, you will be pleased to know, has moved from Denmark to Rio de Janeiro. Well done, the Brazilians. Well done. So they've been strong, convincing.
At least they have this.
Yes.
In this moment,
it's complicated. But now the secretariat has definitely moved officially, everyone from Rio de Janeiro, which is quite a big achievement. Sorry? You should join. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Well, it's a complicated question. Mm-hmm. It's a complicated question in the sense that of course we are talking about oil and gas moving into global value chain, and of course trying to produce local equipment, and at the same time the big bosses, the big international companies, are moving out of the field because they go into renewable energy, into ICT, into. So the question is, isn't really worth going in a big way developing oil industry, whereas in terms of oil cycle or industrial cycle, we are in the decline, the beginning of the decline. That is a key issue, key question. But how much, how long does it take? In spite of the mineral resources are here. And on the other hand, they have no alternative but now to do explore the oil they have until they get some capacity into going into renewable energy. For instance, if you look at these countries which are in the south, a lot of people are saying, well, it's high time we left the oil, the mineral resources, oil, and go for solar. And it happened that solar is also very, very important in those regions, from Arabia right to even Latin America and Africa, solar energy is there. But it's the same way. Unless you have developed previous competences into the sector as a whole, you will not be able to move easily into solar. Because it's more easy to convert than to start from scratch. And in that sense, I go back to your diaspora issue, which is a key issue. In that sense, this is one of the key important issues. That means the people who have been able to do that move from mineral sources to renewable are not there anymore. Because they are going elsewhere to do that sort of thinking, and they are in developed countries, they are in United States, they are in Canada, they are in France, they are particularly, okay? So it is a key issue, and I certainly don't have the answer right now. I will think about it also. It's a big concern. Yes.
So you are not climate skeptic in.
No. Not that.
Okay.
No.
Okay, that was.
No. This is another paper too.
Okay. Thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting. I have one question and one comment. My question is related to the policies that should be implemented both at the national and international level to foster this kind of inclusive development, because as you said, we are in a global pattern where southern countries are mainly producing raw materials from natural resources and they are exporting it to northern countries, which means that northern countries are depending and relying on these natural resources, which have a high environmental costs, and then they can northern countries can have like cleaner industries, and so this is a very unbalanced pattern. But northern countries are taking profit on it, and they are pushing developing countries to open their borders. I don't know if it's for every northern countries, but European Union has quite an aggressive policies this last years about making developing countries opening their borders so they can buy finished products from Europe, for example, and export raw materials. So isn't there a need for international coordination and also some kind of protectionism from the developing countries? And my comment is about the cut flower industry, because I'm sorry,
I address to them, not me.
Yeah, no, but I studied it a little in my other school, and we have to know that this is not a food product. So this kind of industry are using like loads of very toxic products to produce these flowers, and this has a huge environmental impact and social impact. It's mainly produced in countries where you have not so strong regulations, so it's basically killing people there and killing like the environment. So I don't think it's a true good example, but maybe maybe it will include more of I don't know added value, but you have to consider the environmental burden that is once again borne by the developing countries, and that's of course people from northern countries that will buy flowers. I mean, in developing countries, I don't care about flowers. I mean, they will not buy it. They don't understand why we are buying flowers.
They still love flowers too.
Yeah, of course, but. I was in Tanzania, and when they knew that we were buying flowers, they were like, why?
Why are you wasting your money?
Just a comment and just telling people, don't buy flowers if you don't know where they were produced, because it's a disaster.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Well done.
Okay.
So you prepare your answer, okay? I'm not commenting on flowers.
So yeah, my name is Mateus, and I just wanted to ask you about. I wanted to ask you to comment on the lock-in risk that some technologies might cause in a country, because you mentioned that it's much easier for a country to convert from one industrial complex to another one. So I wanted to. Maybe dive in a little bit on this specific comment.
Yes.
Because, in my opinion, maybe on the technical point of view, it might be easier, but I am a bit skeptical on the political easiness of doing it once you already have the industrial complex. That's why the concept of locking in a technology.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because, of course, these industries can lobby and et cetera. And then, on that note, if you could just comment a bit on what's your perspective on open source, breaking with royalties, and the idea of the commons, because in my opinion, that's one of the greatest costs that one industry would have to have in order to start from scratch, start from scratch in this case. So if you could just comment on these things, that would be great. That's it.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So there are three questions, or perhaps a little long, but try to be brief. The first one is, you refer, they are more general, not specific to petroleum. So you first state that it's very important the power position in this process. So my question will be, first is, what defines the power? It's mainly based on the situation, or is there some key factors to define this power? The second will be related to this topic of the gains or the benefits of global value chain. So the first is, there's kind of contradiction with this openness or entering the global value chain. You have first the because you're trying to compete with the state of art. So when you do that, you open, you expose yourself to destroying capacities or to all these problems, or to stop development. But also there's a pressure to be better. So okay, how to deal this perhaps from more a macro or a policy level, because probably you cannot develop some capabilities if you don't have some kind of protection. And the third one would be you say about Petrobras developing a network of suppliers, etc. So what would be some kind of optimal level of vertical integration? To what extent it doesn't become a burden to be fully integrated? What are the critical processes that defines, okay, this is done outside and this is done inside? Because you have to control the knowledge in that integration process, but also you cannot do everything in-house. So that would be.
Okay. Okay. I'm not sure I have a question or answers for everything, but some are interesting to integrate, consider. Yes, let's start with the flowers then. let's start with the flowers, because I am hesitant.
All right, well, the flower question was very interesting, actually. In fact, why we decided to consider Africa a little bit more in detail in our presentation is that because in the paper, it was contrasting African case and the case of Brazil, and it was stating that in Africa there are very little, almost no cases that are successful. So this is why we developed this case study from it's like a pretty famous book, which is called Made in Africa, and right now it's about development policy, and in Africa it was published 2 years ago, 1.5 years ago, basically. And it explains very much in detail different stages and how it helps the country to grow. But of course, you have to think about different other issues that are social issues, and that we also incorporated as the last question that we didn't have time to explore. So maybe you can comment a little bit about the negative effects.
But social implications have been specified by a friend. So she, I don't think the GVC opens the border more than what it is. These countries have already been constrained to open their borders ever since the 1980s, when they all went following their debt burdens. They had to convey some or to accept some strategies which are imposed by the Bretton Woods institution. So there's no more opening than that. It is already wide open. How could you figure out that policy, of course, governments, you might argue some are more open, less. We're looking at Ethiopia, for instance. You're talking about Ethiopia. Ethiopia with the turn of the 2000, maybe in late 90s, the strong left-wing government took over, because Ethiopia is known for military coup, unfortunately. There were, every time when it stabilized, there was a coup. But there was a government which came, and they tried to go against the will of the Bretton Woods institution. And yet they haven't solved the debt burden, because they were opened in the 70s, like every other country. They had to go the withdrawal of the state, play the market, let the investors come in, try to move out and sell flowers. All this part of one move, because the movies say export, whatever you can export, export. If it is flowers, flowers. If it fish, you do it. If you, I was in another country, in Mauritania, about 2 weeks ago, a huge amount of fish is being exported to the world from that country, following the same principles. But that government came and stood against to have a more controlled economy, to have a more less market prone, but more government intervention. That didn't last much. It lasted 5-6 years, and the leader of that movement, which was the not reclosing, but re-controlling the economy, was simply killed, was died. Okay? It is well known. So that movement of trying to go back to protectionist, etc., when you are a fragile country, like Argentina did it, with a certain success. After Eva Perón, they did it to some extent. That's not an easy move to do. So being open at anyhow, it might be, it is better to include a GVC strategy for opening up. How, if we are open, how can we negotiate with the international companies which are operating some more space for local knowledge? And more space for local knowledge is feasible. For instance, you could negotiate that instead of bringing all competences from the local universities, will contract with the company to train some of the operatives, at least semi-skilled. That is already going into this logic of using local knowledge into the GVC. And that has been successfully done in some countries, where they, in Morocco, for instance, in some areas, automotive industry, now most of the people, Peugeot, Renault, most of the people are being at semi-skilled. No one comes from abroad. They have able to put contract to train most of the people there. And that is what? That is also giving the chance of incremental learning and incremental innovation. This is the incremental innovation which we didn't talk earlier. Because when you put these people in the process, they accumulate, they learn, and gradually they move into the area of learning, of competence building, and of technology through that process. So, yes, being open, it is a fact. We are not ignored, we can't minimize, but it is not simply being open through raw material exports and imports of ready-made equipment and services, but being open through playing gradually, wherever it is possible, the value chain. That is the interesting thing. He said, no, you are not completely, as I said, vulnerable or completely locked, using the whoever, you're locked. You're not completely locked with your hands tied, no. If you think in terms of GVC, that opens space for bringing in more local knowledge and gradually entering the GVC. And we have seen, for instance, some of the research in the aeronautics, aerospace industries, is being done in some developing countries. We know that India, it's a long time since they have been doing this, because India is far advanced. But even in Africa, it is happening now. Okay, so that is Why this analysis is interesting? Because it brings a new perspective in terms of either completely closed or completely open. No, there is something in between. We are open, but you gradually negotiate through science, technology, innovation. So in that case, all sorts of, moving on the other question, all sorts of mode of innovation which brings external knowledge to local knowledge to build capacity are welcome. You're talking about open source, yes. Open source, it is an important aspect of building local capacity. And indeed, Petrobras has been using open source without naming it as open source. But you see when there is, this is where organizational innovation comes into it. They have been involving subcontractors into building capacity. And they've been involving users, clients. So open source, now it has some fashionable name called open source. But in fact, a lot of these companies have been using open source without mentioning it for years. And Petrobras has used open source. So it is valid something. The commons, I think I'll say, David is more expert on the commons than me, so perhaps they should refer the question to him. I know he likes this, the commons, so perhaps he can say it. The power position, a key factor. So if I got it right, the power position, what you are saying, it's, in fact, why should it be a power game?
No. The question was, what are the factors that define the power position? Mm. Why? How? Is there a key factor that defines which player is strong or not in this relationship?
Knowledge, to start with, not even money, because if it's money, if you go to negotiate with Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and whatever have you, where does the money balance stand? It stands there. Yet, in spite of the huge money, they could buy anything. But the power position isn't that. Still, Kuwait, still now, important. Anything they want from abroad. So it's not really the money. Money is knowledge, it's capacity. Patents, yeah. Well, that's part of it, you see. Yeah? That's part of this is, when I say knowledge in generic terms, okay? Knowledge in generic terms, that is capacity throughout, over, from, okay? So that is really exactly the, that is also capacity to control the value chain. This is power, capacity to have this controlling various stages of the value chain. In other words, you can actually subcontract, you can hire and fire. This is what power is all about. Hire and fire at all level of the chain, and that is power. You can bring in, if you are not happy with the French supplier of some services, within days, you can bring another one from Thailand, from China, from Brazil. So that capacity of networking and hiring and firing throughout the chain is power. So that, and that, what is that? That is also knowledge, capacity to use. So that's why I think looking at the GVC through the lens of innovation, D&E, and capacity building is really brings in a whole new area of understanding which we didn't have before. And that's why it's something to pursue. I'm not saying I have treated the question as a whole. I told you these are premises. There's still a few things we unclear, which we will be developing in future papers. Now the global value chain at policy level. Well, that's an important issue. That is an important issue because sometimes openness comes through global value chain in clashes with the government, with what people want to do. For instance, the if we look at some of the big national companies, and you find them in Nigeria, you find them in Algeria, you find them in Kuwait, in these countries, and in Latino American countries. One of the reasons why the value chain wasn't fully integrated in strategy is because of political power. they consider it right away as a strategic sector. And as strategic sector, they are not the managers who do the policy of the strategy, not the competences who do strategy. Often it's people at ministerial level who decide what should be done and what should not be done. And it's not always for the good reasons. For instance, if when you say power, it's protection for the good, but also for the worst. We go back to Petrobras. You must accept the fact that this field of natural resources and trade of natural throughout the world is also the object of the highest level of corruption. That is not a marginal thing. Corruption gets that way. The scandal of Petrobras exposed, and etc. So, which means that when you look at the channels for value chain, some of the logic for opening or not opening are not really obvious. Why a government official should resist the fact that you should develop your oil services? Or in some countries, the capacity is there. In some countries, for instance, catering services. What is so simple that supplying catering services locally? That is all thing to do with restaurant, with travel, with transportation for food, with even those minor services are sometimes left for years to companies from abroad because they control. And that is not the obvious. That doesn't make a sense in terms of economic development or sustainable development. It has only a political explanation. And when I say political explanations, it's people who are in GVC have the means to involve themselves into the political decision making through corruption and other means to stop that process of going further into the value chain. This is Sonatrach, which I said. But a long time had the capacity to do many things, yet it didn't do it. And now people wonder, why should they do it? Yet they have competences, they have capacity, there are universities, local universities, research centers. And yet, nothing explains why it should remain at the peripheral. Now they can do, as I said, they will do the pipes, for distribution, it's okay, they do it locally. They involve themselves partially into the oil refining because they have some minor capacity at the peripheral. That's what, after 50 years of being in the field. You see what I mean? So that's the protection. Policy level is one of the key issues. That's, I remember when I drew the lessons from Petrobras, I said one first is political will to go into GVC. If you don't have that political will, there's no problem, no way of going into it. That's part of it. And perhaps the last one, it is related to networks, networking.
About the question about the vertical integration, which, because for in the drilling example you made, you say, okay, you say that there were watching the machinery to explore, and they were saying, okay, this is simple. Mm. Okay, to what extent getting the knowledge to make this simple machine is critical or not? Or to what extent to integrate vertically? Because there is a limit to what could be efficient to integrate. It could become a burden.
Yes, that is a very good point, because if you go through the literature, and particularly some work done by Martin Skorek and Lundvall, recently, 2 years ago, they argue against going into GVC logics. That might be very interesting. The paper they produced last year, published now, they said it's not in the interest of developing countries to go into GVC, because the outcome and the consequences of going into GVC, when you put them the balance, there are more. I think you also mentioned that. Yeah, it's good. It's a good point, because. But there is an article I invite you to read. I send you the references, which has against a case against going into GVC, but as I said, the balance into negative consequences on the local development of industry are higher than the positive aspect. And that is part also of the limits of the argument, and vertical integration comes into that process, okay? So I didn't want to, because I was working for the case for, so I put aside the guest against, but there are against arguments against also. Perhaps we have a chance to do that some other time. Thank you for excellent participation and excellent discussion. You are very.